إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، محمد رسول الله.
صلى الله على طه خير القلب وأحلاها، صلى الله على طه خير القلب وأحلاها.
الصلاة والسلام على شفيع الأنام وعلى الصحب الكرام وآل النبي طه، النبي طه الرسول، النبي تاج القبول، كل هم قد يزول بالصلاة على طه.
صلى الله على طه خير الخلق وأهلها، صلى الله على طه خير الخلق وأهلها.
النبي يا من.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله على سيدنا محمد المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحابته الطيبين الطاهرين ومن دعا بدعوته إلى يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it's of great importance for myself always when I speak about Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah to mention that what is giving the writings of Imam al-Ghazali a different flavor is the fact that they have been written after a real experience of experiencing what he's been writing. So what gives difference to what Imam al-Ghazali has written is the fact that Imam al-Ghazali has written this after experiencing it. And although we are not talking, we're not saying that other scholars have not experienced these things, but Imam al-Ghazali, his experience was very vivid. Imam Abu Hamid Muhammad ibn Muhammad ibn Muhammad al-Ghazali al-Tusi, who was born in 450 and died 504. So he lived for 54 years, rahimahullah, reached a level of scholarship and academia that was unparalleled in the Muslim world. He was the dean of, you can say, the chancellor of a university called the Nizamiya in his area, and then was promoted to be the chancellor of that university in Baghdad, which became, or was actually, the central branch of that university. He was selected by a great king at his time called Nizam al-Mulk. And Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah did not achieve this because he had someone who has connected him with the king. Actually, he was born and his father passed away right after he was born, a few years after he was born. He grew up in a very poor family, but what has made Imam al-Ghazali reach that level is the fact that he has studied and he was a very hard-working student. Imam al-Haramain al-Juwayni, his teacher, who asked Imam al-Ghazali to write something on Usul al-Fiqh, that was the specialty of his teacher. When he saw what he has written, and he was only 28 years old at that time, he said, his teacher said to him, "You have buried me alive," meaning your knowledge is so excellent that I do not have any space to speak about those words that anymore. Al-Ghazali rahimahullah made his way to scholarship and to excellence through debates. Debating, and you're debating with people, theological debating with scholars, proving them wrong, trying to actually, he managed through his discussions and his debate with the scholars to prove that he has intellectual excellence that was not seen before his time. He had such an intellectual excellence, and that can actually be seen in his works that discuss mantiq, logic, philosophy, and after all of this, after all this glory, being the chancellor or the head of the Nizamiya University, Imam al-Ghazali literally humbled all other scholars through his intellectual excellence. After all of this, Imam al-Ghazali left everything. He left glory, he left excellence, he left the limelight. And he decided that all this is unsatisfactory. All this is not pleasing. All this life that we have around us, and this is the starting point, actually, that I want to share with you today, that you might be achieving loads and loads of things in your life, but there is always a vacuum. There is a point which needs to be addressed. You are displeased with yourself. You're not happy. Why? Although you're achieving financially, you might be achieving intellectually, you might be achieving practically and position-wise, you might be achieving dunya-wise, you're achieving, but there is a vacuum. Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahullah, had this vacuum, and therefore he left everything. He even left his wife, he left his children, and actually the turning point in Imam al-Ghazali's life was right after he lost his only one son. He had a son and a daughter. His son was Hamid, and his daughter was Fatima. And when he lost his son had a high temperature, had a fever, simple fever, but it actually deteriorated, it led to deterioration of his health, and he died over 2 days, at the age of 11. So Al-Ghazali was really heartbroken by that, and he realized how insignificant his life. And he left all this excellence, and all this beauty, and actually that was preceded, that coincided with a loss of ability to talk. Imam Al-Ghazali, that his main tool of debating was how to talk to people. He lost that ability. He was unable to open his mouth and speak. So he left everything and he decided that let me go and revisit my life. So the point that I want to bring at the beginning is, brothers, this is a letter to a disciple. This is a letter to one of his students. And he will highlight at the very beginning the fact that we have to stand at a certain point of our life and say, pause for a minute and think, what are we doing with our life? Where are we heading to? Are we in the right direction? Sometimes we're deceived by our actions. Sometimes we're deceived by our egos. Sometimes we are deceived by our achievements. Sometimes we are deceived by what people say about us. Ibn Ataillah Sakandari says, don't be deceived but by what people say about you. Because when people praise you, they're not praising you. In reality, they're praising Allah's cover upon you. Allah has covered you. Allah has covered your reality. People don't know who you are. The only one who knows your reality is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, when they're praising you, they are actually praising how Allah has made you appear to them. And this is a very important starting point that we need to pay heed to tonight, inshaAllah ta'ala. Imam al-Ghazali was very honest with himself. You know, in English they say honesty is the best policy. And in reality, honesty is the best policy dealing with the nafs. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that we have to be honest with ourselves. Reaching that honesty is very difficult. Because you will always be pleased with yourself. And they say that the stem and the fountain of every sin that you commit is pleasure with oneself. If you're always pleased with yourself, you will never see that you are in the wrong point. You will never see that there is something wrong with you. But only when you realize that, no, I'm full of mistakes. There is a problem with me, you reflect. Start being displeased with yourself. And in our life and in our relations with others, we're always displeased with people and pleased with ourselves. If we just shift this and become pleased with people and displeased with ourselves, I think a lot of things will be fine. Because we will overlook a lot of the mistakes that we pick on others. We will forget a lot of the points that we point at with others. We will not be picking on others and say, you are wrong in this and you are wrong in this. But you will always say, I might be wrong in that, I might be wrong in this. This is the essence of neutrality. And this is the essence of starting a new life, treading the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam al-Ghazali went into a very long trip, 10 years, leaving his family behind. He kept himself in the minaret of the Umayyad Mosque in Damascus, reflecting, reading Quran, trying to realize what is Iman? What is wrong with my life? And he wrote all his experience in his book, Al-Ihya, and he came after 10 years of isolating himself from people. He came and he went back to teach, but not in Al-Nizamiya in Baghdad. He went back to teach in a small school in his city of Tus. And he died at the age of 54. But Al-Ghazali, post 10 years of isolation, the post-isolation Ghazali is different from the pre-isolation Ghazali. These are two different individuals. The point that we want to make here today, inshallah ta'ala, is the fact that, brothers and sisters, bear in mind that this honesty is that the first start that you, is the first thing that you have to start with your love, with yourselves. This is my chain to narrating this book. I'm narrating this book from Imam Al-Ghazali, rahimahullah ta'ala, through my Sheikh, the Grand Mufti of Egypt, the former Grand Mufti of Egypt, Mawlana Sheikh Ali Jum'a, who said it has been narrated to us by Sheikh Muhammad Yasir ibn Muhammad Isa al-Fadani, who said it has been narrated to us by Abu al-Hasan Ali ibn Khalid al-Khairi, and Amatullah, daughter of Abdul Ghani al-Dihlawiya, from Abdul Ghani al-Dihlawi, that's her father, from Muhammad Abid al-Sindi, from Yusuf al-Misjaji, from Muhammad Ala al-Din al-Misjaji, from Abdullah ibn Salim al-Basri, from Muhammad ibn Ala al-Din al-Babuli, from Ahmad al-Sanhuri, from Ahmad ibn Hajar al-Haytami, from Sheikh al-Islam Zakaria al-Ansari, from Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, from Abi Hayyan ibn Abi Hayyan, from his grandfather, from Abu Ali ibn Abi al-Ahwas, from Ibn Qasim al-Khazraji, from Al-Qadi Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Arabi, from Al-Imam Hujjat al-Islam Abi Hamid Muhammad ibn Muhammad ibn Muhammad al-Ghazali or al-Ghazali al-Tusi. This book is actually, its importance is highlighted in the first, in the introduction. Imam al-Ghazali himself says, bear in mind that one of the advanced students of knowledge who has studied with me and has mastered all sciences asked me, asking for an advice. He sent me a message asking for an advice. And there are a few points that I want to raise with you here. Number one, this is a message that was sent by Imam al-Ghazali by one of his students, advanced students. After studying with al-Ghazali for so many years, that student wrote to his teacher. And he said, listen, I've been studying with you for so many years, and I want you to write. I know that you have given me so many pieces of advice. You guys attend too many lectures, don't you? You attend too many events. But have you, take too many notes, isn't it? But have you ever thought of asking someone to write a small piece of advice, a paragraph, and you keep that with you all the time? And every day you take it out from your pocket and you look into it and you say, what have I done with this? Will we never think about the notes that we take? What have I done with them? You listen here and there. You listen from this chair and that chair. The importance is not what you have listened to. The importance is attached to what you have put into action. Al-Ghazali himself, rahimahullah, says, لَيْسَ الْعِلْمُ مَا سُمِعْ بَلِ الْعِلْمُ مَا نَفَعْ. Knowledge is not what you hear. It is what benefits you. It's what you take and you go and put that into action. If knowledge is not going to change you, there is no benefit in your knowledge, and in actuality, it will be against you. Yeah. Mastership of sciences goes through three or four stages. One, we have beginner students. Beginner students are concerned with reading the basic masail or the basic points of the science. And then we have a bit of intermediate students. These intermediate students, their main concern is how can I prove this issue with a dalil, with an evidence. And then we have a bit of advanced upper intermediate students. They are basically busy with how can I fortify this evidence with another evidence. How can I attach similar issues to the main issue which I have studied? So the specific rule, how can I apply that? But then the advanced students, they start asking themselves, Have I done justice to this knowledge? Have I put it into action? What have I done with it? Now I know the masail. Now I know the dalils. Now I know all these things. What have I done with it? So Imam al-Ghazali highlights that this is an advanced student. If you really study, if you're really smart, you should be focused on that. And he says he occupied himself with the acquisition of knowledge. A lot of us, when we ask for advice, brothers and sisters, we come asking for advice and we don't know what are we looking for. Really? Isn't it? You come to a sheikh or to a teacher or someone you believe that he's a righteous person and you say, sheikh, give me a piece of advice. On what? What do you actually, when you go to the doctor, what do you do? Do you say, look, I have a problem. You tell me what shall I do with it? Or you tell him, I'm complaining of this and this. Based on your complaint, he will check you. And then he will write the proper prescription. Without you telling him, where is the pain? He will not be able to figure out. He does not have a magical stick that can discover where is the complaint. He cannot do that. You have to tell him, well, I'm complaining of my nose, or I'm complaining of my lips, or I'm complaining of my tummy. And these are the signs of the complaint. And then he will take that, verify it according to, against what he has, by testing you, putting the stethoscope on you. And then he will check your temperature, he will check your blood pressure, and he will check if you're diabetic, he will check all these things, and then at the end he will decide that the problem is not here, it's there. When you have a plumber, when you get a plumber at home, you don't take him to your toilet and say, oh, there's a problem with the toilet, go find him. This is like putting the man into a maze, isn't it? Putting him into a labyrinth. You tell him, listen, there is some leak in this area. I don't know exactly where it is coming from, but there is a problem here. And then he will take that and he will verify. Possibly your diagnosis is not correct. So Imam al-Ghazali said that the first thing that you should be busy with is occupy yourself with acquisition of knowledge. Basic knowledge. And then when you have a complaint or you want a piece of advice, you need to ask the person, I have this problem, what do you advise me with? If we reflect on the ahadith that has been narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we realize that the Sahaba have always asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam very specific questions, very clear questions. Mu'adh ibn Jabal to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, dullani ala amali, idha amiltuhu, ahabbani al-nas, wa ahabbani Allah. Tell me about one deed. If I do it, not too many deeds, one thing. If I do it, people will love me and Allah will love me as well. Another man, Ya Rasulullah, if I do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, will I be admitted to paradise? Yes. Very clear. Ya Rasulullah, give me an advice regarding this issue. And the Prophet ﷺ will give the advice. Ya Rasulullah, if this happens, what shall we do? The Prophet ﷺ will give the advice. Asking a question, aimless question, is as wrong as looking for an aimless answer. It's actually an indication that you're looking for a haphazard answer. And you will not benefit from that. When you ask, say, I want you to advise me regarding this. And that's the first one that Imam al-Ghazali tells us, that this nasiha, that's why Imam al-Ghazali didn't have to write a lot. He wrote a few pages. Because this student said, listen, I have studied with you, I have achieved a lot of knowledge, but I want you to tell me, to write in these pages a few pieces of advice for me that I can keep till the rest of my life. I have mastered knowledge, but now I want to know what am I supposed to do next. So he mastered the sciences and filled out the good qualities of the soul. And then he reflected after long company with Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah. And this is, he reflected on his previous life. I have been with the Imam for many years. What have you done? Some of us are attending, as I said, Islamic activities. Zikr halaqat. You're going to visiting people. What have you done over these 5, 6, 7, 8 years, 2 years? What have you done? Where were you and where are you? And where are you expecting yourself to be in 2 years' time? Where are you expecting yourself to be in 5 years' time? What are your aims in life? What do you want to do? How do you want to see yourself in 5, 6 years? Or you just want to be the same? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, "Man kana yawmuhu mithla amsi, fahuwa maghdub." If today is like yesterday for you, you're deceived. You're definitely deceived. Your life is cheating you. Because you're losing. In reality, you're losing every day. You're growing older. How many years are you going to live? And how many years you have lived? And are you actually waiting to live long? Are you actually sure that you're going to live eternally? So, what have you done? Where are you expecting yourself to be in 2 years' time, in 3 years' time, in 5 years' time, in 10 years' time? Oh, actually, if you are smarter, you should be asking yourself, what am I expecting myself to be tonight? And tomorrow morning? You should have these short-term plans. Many of us have very long-term plans. And because we have very long-term plans, what happens is we fall into the abyss of worries, disasters. We're worried. What is going to happen in 2 years for me? You don't have to plan for 2 years because you might not actually live till 2 years. Plan for a week. Plan for a day. Imam al-Ghazali says at the very end of that piece of advice something really interesting. He said, make sure that you don't save more than the food of the day. Make sure that you don't have, if you want to save food, just save the food of the day. Keep that. And that's it. Don't worry about tomorrow. Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam used to say, our Lord, save us the food of the day, as for tomorrow, you are entrusted with that. We don't care about tomorrow. Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala used to say, إِذَا أَصْبَحْتُ عِنْدِ الْقُوتُ يَوْمِي فَخَلِّ الْهَمَّ عَنِّي يَا سَعِيدُ. If I have the food of the day, then I'm happy. I'm relaxed. وَلَا تَخْتُلُوا مُغَدٍ بِبَالِ. And tomorrow's worries should not attack my mind. فإن غدا له رزق جديد. For tomorrow has a new risk. Allah will give you tomorrow something else. I don't know. Relax. The first thing this student has asked himself, which we need to take today, is what is the fruit of what you have learned? You have been studying, or you have studied, or you have learned something, or you have studied a bit. What is the fruit of that? What is the benefit of that? How has that reflected in your life? How has that reflected in your character? How has that reflected in your relation with others? Number two, and that's a very important question. Is knowledge an aim in itself? When you are learning, are we learning because we just want to learn? A lot of us, including myself, you will be putting a lot of books in your computer. But then you ask, and you put that in a big folder called my library. But do you actually read that library? Before you put the book, have you finished the books that are already there? Sometimes you just buy for the sake of buying. Sometimes you're just reading for the sake of reading. You know, in the West, when you get into the tube, you have the metro, you will find the subway, in other words, the tube is a London-specific word. So when you get into the tube, you'll find everyone holding a book. Right? A lot of people are holding books. And I look at that with a bit of surprise. I say, it's a good thing to read. But what are you reading? That's a very important thing. Many people are reading Harry Potter, isn't it? Or obviously, if I say Pride and Prejudice, it will be too old. That's too outdated. Because I haven't probably read any English literature for some time. Quite a long time. But I mean, people do read, but they don't know why are they reading. Just reading because it's a habit, or because it's a pleasure. So this is exactly like someone else who's doing video games, who's playing video games. Or someone who's doing some computer games or anything like that. Just spending time in something that they want, or something that gives them pleasure and happiness. Same thing, they have replaced that with reading. In Islam, we don't read for the sake of reading. We read because we want this reading to change us. Is knowledge an aim? If knowledge is an aim, then computer is much more knowledgeable than you. What has made you a human being is not the knowledge that you have at your brain, but in reality, the Sahaba, in terms of physical knowledge and memorization, they were much, much, much less than the people who came afterwards. Right? But what's the difference between us and Sahaba? The difference between us and the companions of the Prophet is action. What were they doing? Umar ibn Khattab spent 10 to 12 years memorizing Surah Al-Baqarah. Not because he had a bit of a problem in his memorization. No, because he did not move from one ayah before he puts that into action. So he took Surah Al-Baqarah as a plan for life. Imam Al-Ghazali said, the student said, a few pages with me for the rest of my life. I want a few pages with me for the rest of my life. This student is looking for quality. Nowadays we're looking for quantity. We just gather things. We gather books. We gather notes. We attend events. And I always say to people, you're jumping from one event to another event. What have you done? Be a bit selective. Be a bit selective in what you read. Be a bit selective in what you want in life. And if you reach that point, the point of self-criticism, you see that you need to wake up. This is a good thing. You are in a state of being displeased with yourself. This is a good thing. Imam Al-Sharishi, rahmatullahi, one of the Shafi'i masters, he has written a poem in fixing in the stages of the path to Allah. And he said that the first stage is a state called self-censure. Being displeased with yourself. Starting to criticize. What's wrong with me? So he said, rahimahullah, إِذَا مَا بَدَأَ مِنْ بَاطِنٍ حَالَةُ السَّجْرِ فَمَا هُوَ إِلَّا الْبَرُّ الْبِرُّ مِنْ مِنْحَةِ الْبَرِّ. When a person finds himself in a state of self-censure, it is but a gift of the gifts of the generous, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a gift from Allah that has put yourself in that state. Otherwise, you had left you to heedlessness. Otherwise, you had left you to be asleep. And that state is called yaqadha, wakefulness. Only when you wake up, you will realize that all the dreams that you were having were just dreams. Only when you wake up, you will start real action. As long as you are asleep, you are just dreaming. You want to do this, you want to do this, you want to do that. But are you actually doing anything? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the worst person is the one who does not do anything and he just asking Allah, give me this, give me this, give me that. Or he wishes to enter paradise and he has not done anything for it. And he thinks, I'm thinking good of Allah, Allah will not fail me. Yes, Allah will not fail you, but how are you failing yourself? You know, we all know this saying of Isa ibn Maryam that helps only those who help themselves. So Imam al-Sharisi rahimahullah says, وَمِنْ حُكْمِ حَالِ الْإِنْتِبَاهِ إِذَا بَدَى شُهُودُكَ حَالَ النَّفْسِ فِي غَايَةِ الْفَقْرِ. For the state of wakefulness leads the person to witness himself in a state of absolute destitute, that I'm not good for anything, that in reality my relation with Allah needs to be better, my relation with my family needs to be better, my relation with the world needs to be better, I should stop thinking ill of people. The first step to move forward, the first step to take, to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to learn something, is to seek sincere advice. First step into positive knowledge is to seek advice, to ask people, what do you see in me? Tell me honestly, where am I wrong? And obviously not to ask everyone, because people will give you different pieces of advice. But to choose one person whom you trust his knowledge, you trust his action, you trust his understanding, and you say, and he has been in your company for a long time, that he knows who you are, and then tell him, listen, you've been in my company for so many years, what do you see that I'm in fault? What am I supposed to do with myself? And he has to be an honest person, otherwise he'll just cheat you and say, you're fine. You're absolutely fine. Don't worry about yourself. You know, sometimes we tend to relax with people who always give us credit. And if someone is discrediting us, we say, oh, he's my enemy. I don't like that person. I don't like the way he's talking to me. The Quran tells us that the people of one of the cities, the city of Antioch, although the Quran does not name it, the city of Antioch, they were gifted with three prophets. Two prophets, and they refused them. And then the Quran says, and we sent the third one in Surah Yasin. وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلًا أَصْحَابَ الْقَرْيَةِ إِذْ جَاءَهَا الْمُرْسَلُونَ إِذْ أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهِمُ اثْنَيْنِ. We sent two messengers for them. فَكَذَّبُوهُمَا. They rejected them. فَعَزَّزْنَا بِثَالِثٍ. So we sent the third one. And they refused him as well. At the very end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to them a man, an advisor, from the farthest side of the city. This man, he is not a messenger, he's just a normal person. He came and he told them two simple sentences. يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُوا الْمُرْسَلِينَ. My people, follow the messengers. Number two, اتَّبِعُوا مَنْ لَا يَسْأَلُكُمْ أَجْرًا وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. They are not asking you for any credit. They don't want anything from you. Nowadays, everything you get, you have to pay for. Everything that you get, you have to give something in return. But when someone is telling you, yeah, there is something wrong with you here, and there is something wrong with you here, instead of actually saying, that's not your business, why do you have to tell me this? Go and look at yourself. You're full of mistakes. You should say, thank you very much. Because number one, he doesn't want anything from you. And number two, he's expecting you to be harsh with him. So no one would ever put himself in a situation of advising you unless he loves you. Obviously not by scandalizing you in front of people, but by telling you in between you and him. They say, مَنْ نَصَحَكَ مَا بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ فَقَدْ نَصَحَكَ. He who advises you in between you and him, he actually advises you. This man said, follow those who are not asking you for any credit, they don't want any money. وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. And they are guided. Some people might not be willing to take anything from you, but they want to take you with them into misguidance. Someone who hates you, he doesn't want anything from you. But as much as he's gone into misguidance, he just wants to take you with him. So he wants to spoil you just for the sake of spoiling you. But these people who are righteous, if someone who offers you cigarettes to smoke, he might not want anything from you, but he just wants you to smoke. Because he knows that this is a bad thing. He just wants to spoil you. Someone who is offering, who's taking you to drink, or is taking you in the wrong way, in reality, he is misleading you. He might not need anything from you. Yes, because I believe that smoke is haram. Some people might disagree with that, but I believe that smoking is haram. It's absolutely haram. There is a fatwa in the House of Fatwa of Egypt that says that smoking is haram. Now it's haram. According to doctor's advice as well. So we ask the people of expertise. Anyway, moving on from this, some people might just mislead you because they want to see you misled. They want to spoil your family because their families are already spoiled. So they don't want to see you in a good... Why are you going to be happy while I'm miserable? No, they don't want that. No, but the messengers, they want you to be in a good state. They sacrifice their own lives for you to be happy. So the first step of knowledge is to seek advice. You should go and tell people, honest people, what is wrong with me? Tell me. One, advice is one of the characteristics of this ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You should command what is good. And you should combat what is evil. You should advise people, this is not good. And you know, when morality becomes a very simple issue in a society, lack of morality will be the norm. The problem that we have in the world today, especially in the West, is people are trying to normalize our perspective to morality. So they say, Islam should tolerate. Well, I have no problem tolerating individuals, but I cannot accept something that runs against my principle. Lying is lying, isn't it? Theft is theft. Probably at a certain stage in history, people will start seeing theft as a norm, isn't it? Seeing it as an acceptable practice. Possibly, if people's morality changes, they might see that lying, actually lying in certain societies, is seen as intelligence. Well, you can get yourself out of so many troubles by lying. But as a Muslim, what do I see that as? Lying. You can call it whatever, but I still call it lying. Marriage is marriage. If you want to define it in any way, this is how I see its definition. You can define it the way you want, but this is a universal concept. You cannot change it. So when people become normalized when it comes to morality, then the society will be able to shake in its principles. And once it shakes its principles, there will be chaos. Moral chaos. Political chaos. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when my ummah is afraid to say to an unjust person, you are unjust. A person who is a tyrant, and my ummah is not even able to say to him, oh, you are a tyrant, this is wrong. At least, then there is no hope in them. The Quran tells us about some people from Banu Israel who violated the Sabbath. They were commanded by God not to do anything on the Sabbath. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested that they were by the seaside. So they were tested. A lot of whales and fish would come on the Friday night. And they were commanded, Friday night, no work. You should dedicate yourself to ibadah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that to them, and He sent to them these whales to test if they're going to leave that for dunya or not. If they're going to twist the word of God or not. So they said, there is no problem, you know what we'll do? The seaside, we'll just make canals that are leading to very deep holes or pits, like wells. And obviously, when these wells come, they will go through these canals, they'll fall into these pits. They try to get out back to the sea, they can't. It's like a trap, because it's deeper than the sea level, and the water is falling into it. So they said, we will not do anything, we'll just dig this. And on the Friday night, what we'll do is we will close the entrance. Once they are in, we'll close the entrance that leads them back. It's a simple thing. I'll just do this on a Friday night. And there were three groups in the city. One said, this is unacceptable. Another group said, no, no, we'll do it. It's fine. We're not doing too much. And there was a third group who said, oh, we don't care. We have nothing to do with this. If these people are corrupt, let them be corrupt. We don't care. We're just focusing on our life. And then when the punishment of Allah came, it punished two groups, not only one. It punished those who have done it and those who were silent about it. We have a responsibility to tell someone who is doing something wrong, you are doing something wrong, whether he's going to be happy or unhappy. Because what we care for is the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Normally advice is heavy. Advice is heavy. It's like taking a rock and throwing it at someone. You're telling someone his mistakes. You know, even if you go to the doctor and you're diabetic and he tells you you can't eat this and this and this and that. Although you know very sure, you're very sure that this is for you. At the end of the day, you find it very heavy, isn't it? You find it very difficult to abide by doctor's advice. A lot of our failures in our health and our health problems happen because we don't stick to a doctor's advice. Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah told us that this is one of the characteristics of the ummah. You have to tell people, this is wrong. But what is your responsibility? There is another responsibility. Yes, you have to give advice, but there is something called etiquettes of advice. When we don't fulfill that, when we don't abide by that, one of the problems that happen is that people don't accept our advice. So first of all, you have to plan. How am I advising this person? How can I get the best out of him? How can I make this person listen to my advice? It's not just only about telling him off or criticizing him, no. It's about creating a change in this person's life. One, the first etiquette is that you have to do it with love, not criticism. You should make the person feel that you are not picking on him. You should also credit him before you discredit him. You credit him before you discredit him. You know the original word was what? Credit. And we just added a prefix. So put the credit first, put the credit forward. Oh, you're good in this and this and that, and he's happy, like a balloon. Now when he's really happy, you say, but you know, you would become better if you do this and that. Or I see that there is a sentence, you say, ah, but I see, you say, what are you planning to say? No, you should make the person feel that you're actually keen to make him a better person. And you should strive for this. Number two, foil it with sweet words. You know, when our sisters want to put something in the oven, what do? If they want to keep it warm for a long time, and they foil it. If they want to cook it well, they put it in foil. So foil your work. If it's a big chicken or something, you will foil it well. So if it's a big advice, foil it with sweet words. You know, when you want to give your kid some medication, and it's very bitter medication, what do? Put it in juice, isn't it? If you just put 2-3 drops in the morning in the juice that the kids love. If they are smart kids, they will still discover it. But doesn't matter, right? Or if they want to give you some tablets, and they're very bitter, they sweeten them. It's sugar-coated tablets. So make sure that when you give someone an advice, it's so bitter. It's so heavy upon someone to listen to, someone criticizing him. Foil it with the best of words. And thirdly, choose the right time. Sometimes, as husbands and wives, we choose the wrong time. As families, we choose the wrong time. With our kids, we choose the wrong time. With people at work, we choose the wrong time. With people in the masjid, we choose the wrong time. Something bad happens. Or a person is not praying properly. Or he's done something in Salah. Right after Salah, the person next to him, and he come. Can I tell you something? And then he takes him to the corner. Everyone knows that he's going to criticize him. And he says, no, I'm criticizing him between me and him. Yes, but the introduction has scandalized the guy. You've basically told everyone that you are going to advise him. Or right after Salah, the Imam looks at people and he starts saying, how come people are doing this and this and this? You don't have any sense. Or pick it up on someone, watch out what you're doing. It's wrong. Wait until the people forget it. 1 day, 2 days. But if you really love someone, you will keep that at the back of your mind. Because if you have a plan for a change in your life, what do? You keep your aims at the back of your mind. And you want this person to change. So it doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be today. Because if you do it on the spot, you're gathering two things. Number one, heaviness of the advice. And number two, the fact that the person is embarrassed. Choose the right place. Don't do it in front of people. And be sincere and give hope and tell the person, listen, I know that you are a good person. I just want you to be better. I just want you to be a better person. So Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala said to his student, there are a few important things before I give you my advice. Number one, it's important to pay heed to this advice. It's important to pay heed to this advice. Sometimes we listen to people's advice and we are saying, okay, mashallah, thank you very much. And then we take it from one ear and get it out from the other. We don't pay attention to it. Sometimes we listen to the person and at the back of my mind, he's going to have a go at me now. Right? So let me just listen to him and then afterwards I'll just be relieved. No. Pay heed to it. Why? It concerns you. It doesn't concern him. It's no one except you. Number two, beware of neglecting it. Neglecting advice is a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is displeased with you. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with you, He will enable you to listen to advice. And number three, expound the reasons. Imam al-Ghazali told us, told his student, what are the reasons that would lead the person to refuse advice? You know, it is as if he's analyzing you, saying, listen, if you refuse this advice, it's not a good thing. And let me tell you, why would you be refusing it? So if you're honest with yourself, you will acknowledge these reasons. Number one, feeling it is bitter. You will not. You will reject the advice because it's so bitter, it's so unpleasant. Why? Because you're following your whim and desire. You have a habit. And you can't break this habit, you can't get rid of it. You're addicted to a specific action. You can't get out of it. And they say you will not be able to master and control yourself unless you break your habit. You know, if you're eating something, or you're doing something and you want to change your life, you have to break your habit. If you get angry so easily, you have to try to lower your anger. If you think ill of people, you have to combat that and find excuses. And if there is no excuse, you should find one of 70 excuses. If there is no 70 excuses, you should say to yourself, possibly there is one, but I don't know. And nowadays, we have all reasons to think ill of people. We have the internet, we have Facebook, we have all sorts of, we have the phones. We talk to people and we don't know what are the impressions on their faces. What situation they're talking to us while they're in. All these reasons give us very easy excuses to think ill of people. They give us a lot of excuses to let the shaitan jump in and say, okay, they said assalamu alaikum in an unpleasant tone. Possibly the line has cut. There was a cut in the line. Possibly the person is suppressed or he's kind of upset because of something else. You have not seen the person. Nowadays we live behind barriers. Even inside the one house, people communicate via SMS. Right? People depend on WhatsApp more than they depend on personal meetings and talking to each other. And phones will not speak better than hearts. You have to understand this. Phones will never speak better than hearts. So we need a plug. You see? Otherwise you will need to print out the presentation for me. Number two, being misled by false understanding of knowledge. A lot of people think that knowledge means that I have knowledge. How come that this person is advising me? Doesn't he know that I know? Doesn't he think that I'm better than him? Look, how many years I've been reading this and I know this and I know that. But the problem is, it doesn't matter how long have you been living in this world. You could have been like this man. There was a man called Thomas the Wise. And they called him the Wise as a sarcastic name. There was no wise or anything. Thomas, and that was a real character by the way. This is not an imaginary character. This is a real character. He lived at the time. His name was Thomas, son of Abraham, son of Isaac. He was a Copt from Egypt. At the time of Salahuddin. Thomas, you see, we need a plug. Thomas, this man, his father was a very famous medical doctor. And he inherited a huge library from his father. So he thought to himself, you know what? I don't need to study in order to be as famous as my father. It's as simple as this. I just need to read the books of medicine that is in my father's library. No, hold on. Reading books is not enough. Your father, he said, no. It's okay. I will just read the books. If I read the books, I'll be better than my father even. My father got this by reading books, so there is no problem. So they said to him, no, books will not make you a scholar. Books will not make you a great man. That's one of the things I like about Sidna says lady all the time, mashallah, the plan B. So this man, Thomas the Wise, he thought that with books he will be able to manage. And what he did, he was a very strange man. He thought to himself, okay, let me treat people with the little knowledge that I have of medicine. He treated a few people and they passed away. So he said, okay, I'm not going to treat anyone anymore because this is too dangerous. But let me go and advise people. I'll be a warrior and orator. So he picked up some books of Christianity and he found that one of the wasaya of Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam was that. Muscle, can I give you this? He read some books of Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam, and he read in the books of Isa ibn Maryam that Isa alayhi salam was saying to his disciples, those who have should give those who do not have. Those who have should give those who do not have. So he went around and he realized that there is a big problem in marriage in the society. A lot of young people are not married. So he went to the fathers who have a lot of daughters and he said, you should give your daughters to these people, donate them. They said, excuse me, what was that? Donate our daughters? Daughters are not donated. They can be given in marriage, but not donation. He said, no, Isa ibn Maryam says, you have to, those who have should give those who do not have. They said, but he's talking about something else. No, there is nothing that specifies this in the books. They said, no, you did not need a book to become a scholar. You needed someone to explain what does it mean. They said, do you think, in Arabic they say, do you think, أَتَحْسَبُ أَنَّبِ الْكُتْبِ وَحْدَهَا تَصِيرُ كَبِيرٌ. Do you think that only by books you will be a big person? أَلَمْ تَرَى أَنَّ الدَّجَاجَ بِرِيشٍ لَا تَطِيرٌ. Haven't you seen that a chicken has a lot of feather, but it doesn't fly? It cannot fly. Why? Because it's completely... Knowledge is a completely different thing. It's a completely different process. So this man, Thomas, when he did that to people, people said, oh, this is a stupid guy. He's telling us to donate our daughters. And he used to ride a donkey and go around the city. Right? Telling people, if you don't do this, Allah will not admit you to paradise. If you donate your daughters, Allah will admit you to paradise. So they made two lines of poetry and put it on the tongue of his donkey. They made as if the donkey is speaking to him. So they put these two lines of poetry and they said, this is an imaginary conversation between the donkey and the owner of the donkey. Who is on top of who? The owner is on top, isn't it? So they said, the donkey of Thomas the Wise said once, لَوْ أَنْصَفُونِي لَكُنْتُ أَرْكَ. If things are in the right position, I should be on top of you instead of you being on top of me. Meaning, you should be in the place of the donkey and I should be in the place of the owner of the donkey. Why? He had a very valid reason, by the way. He said, because my ignorance is simple ignorance. Simple ignorance is that I don't know. But compound or complicated ignorance is that you know things the wrong way. Because firstly, I will have to tell you that this is wrong. Secondly, I have to teach you what is right. So this man thought that he knows. Ibn Ahmad ibn Hanbal used to say, الناس أربعة. There are four categories of people. رجل يدري ويدري أنه يدري. There is a man who knows and he knows that he knows. So you go and ask him. But there is one who knows, but he doesn't know that he knows. He's humble. So go and tell him, you know, can we ask you? You know, you're a qualified person. ورجل لا يدري ويدري أنه لا يدري. There is someone who does not know. But he knows that he does not know. He knows that he is in need of learning. He knows that I need advice. I need to develop. He's honest with himself. فَذَٰلِكَ طَالِبٌ فَعَلِّمُ. This is a seeker. Teach him. You've got to teach him. You have a responsibility. And there is a fourth person. رَسُلٌ لَا يَدْرِي وَلَا يَدْرِي إِنَّهُ لَا يَدْرِي. He does not know, but he does not know that he does not know. He thinks that he knows. فَذَٰلِكَ جَاهِلٌ فَجْتَرِبُ. This is an ignorant person. Avoid him. There is no point. Al-Ghazali, at the end of this advice, I'm linking the beginning to the end, because we will have very tight time. Al-Ghazali, at the very end of the advice, he says, never teach a foolish person. You know who's a foolish person? Someone who thinks that he has knowledge. A foolish person is not someone who does not know. But it's someone who thinks that he has knowledge. And you keep telling him, this is not knowledge. He says, no, I know. I know. A lot of people nowadays, they will tell you, this is bid'ah. Okay, what's the proof that this is bid'ah? He will say, the Prophet didn't do it. Tell him, this is a claim. Because bid'ah equals the Prophet didn't do it, isn't it? So how can you make the claim the evidence? One of the wise people was visited by a student of knowledge who said, can I debate with you? He said, yes, with 10 conditions. One, لا تخطب, don't be angry. Two, لا تعجب, don't be surprised. If I show you a piece of advice or some knowledge, don't say, oh, I haven't come across this before. That's not an evidence. That's actually against you. That shows how limited you are. Thirdly, لا تتعب, don't be exhausted. We can debate for 2-3 days. Don't come at a point and say, okay, enough is enough. I don't want to continue. This is wrong. This is defeatedness. And fourthly, he said, وَلَا تَضْحَكْ, don't laugh at me. Don't laugh at me. Number five, he said, وَلَا تَنْظُرْ لِأَحَدٍ طَالَمَا أُكَلِّمَكْ, don't look at someone else while I'm talking to you. While I'm talking to you, you focus with me. And don't bring in another issue before we have finished the issue that is in hand. A lot of people bombard you with questions because they're weak. And I tell them, listen, hold on. Let's take it one by one. Let's clear one first, and then you clear two, and then you clear three, and then you clear four. And then he said to him, وَلَا تَتَّخِذِ الدَّعْوَى أَصْلَ بَيِّنَةِ, don't make the claim, the evidence. Don't say it is bid'ah, what's the proof? The Prophet didn't do it. That's the claim. Oh, this is my house. What is the proof that it is your house? I live here. Oh, that's the claim. Oh, what is the proof? The proof has to be separate from the claim itself. So Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahullah, tells us that don't be misled by thinking that you know. You're always in need of knowing. You're always in need of advice. Then the second important thing in this advice, or in this letter to the disciples, so the first thing is, how can we accept advice? What is debarring us from accepting advice? Actually, before that, what's wrong with our life? Two, how can we change our life through advice? Okay, so one, we listen to so many pieces of advice. Why are we not changing? And thirdly, I have a little knowledge. What have I done with that? This is a very important and very crucial question. What have I done with that? Al-Ghazali says, bear in mind that mere knowledge will not help. He says, rahimahullah ta'ala, that if you have a great knowledge, is everything all right? Someone is playing with the lights at the back. Alhamdulillah, if they turn off the lights, alhamdulillah, the lights on your face will be much more than enough, inshallah. So, Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahullah ta'ala, says, listen, even by knowing something that is not enough, you can study theoretical medicine, but you don't know how to practice it. That does not make you a doctor. He gives us an advice. He says, if you have a medication for fever, and you know that this medication is good for this fever, unless you use it, it will not help you. If you know archery, or if you know fighting, you are a master of fighting, and you know how to use the sword, and you have a sword next to you, and a lion is coming to attack you, unless you use it, put this knowledge into action, it will not be of any benefit. You might keep holding to your sword and you die. In Egypt, you have a song that says about a weak man. Some people came to his house and he was so coward to go, and they were thieves. He was so coward to go and face them. So he waited, and they went in and they took a big box of gold. They ran away. So later on, his brother came to him and he said, 2 days after, he looked at him and he was crying. He said, why are you crying? He said, the thieves came in and then they took all the gold, the box of gold. And his brother's name was Muhammad. So he says, okay, if they have taken the gold and ran away, why didn't you call the police? Why didn't you face them? Why didn't you, like, you do anything? Why are you crying? He said, oh, no, it's okay. Don't worry. They've taken the box, but I have the key. I have the key to the box. What are you going to do with the key? He said, yes, they will not be able to open it. They don't need to open it. They don't need to open it with the key. When there is a thief, he's not going to come and knock the door. Excuse me, it's anyone in here? They will come regardless. So you have to be smart and have to know, what have I done with this knowledge? The benefits of knowledge, of putting knowledge into action, we don't estimate that. Number one, removing the sin of not practicing. Allah will ask you on the day of Qiyam, what have you done with this knowledge? And if you have not put it into action, there is a sin. You're sinful. So at least put some of it into action. Imam Ibn Raslan, rahimahullah, says, if you have memorized something, at least put 10% of it into action. فَعْمَلْ وَلَوْ بِالْعُشْرِ كَالزَّكَاةِ. You know, like zakah, If you are growing some agricultural crops, you have to give one-tenth of it as a zakat. If you don't, all your money will not be blessed. If it is cash money, it's 2.5%. So Imam Ibn Raslan says, act upon one-tenth of what you know. Not everything. If you have memorized 10 hadiths, act upon one. If you have memorized 100 hadiths, act upon 20. If you have memorized 10 ayat of the Quran, take one and put it into action. And then you will relax. You will realize, but I mean by putting it into action, putting that in front of you all the time. Some of the Salihin who were appointed in kind of a leading positions, they put a big ayah in front of them. وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Fear a day when you will return to your Lord. So every time they're about to do some injustice, you look at that, fear the day when you will stand in front of Allah. Fear the day when you will be standing in front of Allah. When Abu Khazin, who was one of the Tabi'in, was taken to Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, and Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf was a tyrant, and he was working under the kind of the supervision of the Khalifa Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik. So he started admonishing and advising him and saying, you should not be doing this. Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf said, I'm just a worker. I'm just fulfilling what my master is asking me. Al-Walid is telling me, do this, and I'm doing it. So if there is any injustice, he would be questioned about it. He said, Ya Hajjaj, fear Allah. Fear the Lord of Al-Walid for a day when Al-Walid will not be of any benefit for you. Fear the Lord of Al-Walid for a day, for the day of Qiyamah, where Al-Walid himself will not be of any benefit for you. On that day, he will not be helping you. So ask yourself, what have I done with this knowledge? I talk to people about mercy, have I practiced that? I talk to people about care, have I practiced that? I talk to people about sacrifice, have I practiced that? Number two, strengthening. It's understanding in one's mind. You will not understand something properly unless you practice it. You will not understand how does mango tastes until you drink it. Yes, you can read the description. You know, they say that Ash'ab was a very greedy man. And he used to visit kings and sultans. And they used to laugh with him and joke with him because he was a very funny man at the same time. So when he came to one of the khulafa, he said, Ya Ash'ab, tell me which of the two types of sweet is better. There were two types of sweet dessert. One was called Al-Luzayanj and another was called Al-Faluvanj. These are traditional sweets that are extinct now. Like no one knows how to do it anymore. But anyway, two types of sweet. He said, which one of the two desserts is better? So Ash'ab was very smart. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, la ahkumu ala ghanim. I cannot judge something that is not in front of me. Meaning, get me two plates, one of each, and let me eat them. And then I'll judge and tell you which one of the two desserts is better. You can't judge something that you have not seen. So he said, okay, bring him two big plates. So they brought two big plates, one of this type and one of that type. And then he started having one of this, one of that, and one of this, and one of that. After half an hour, the Khalif has said to him, you've been eating for half an hour, you haven't said anything. Which one of the two is better? He said, yeah, every time I'm trying to judge in favor of one, the other gives me his evidence. No, hold on, I have another argument. So in reality, how can you judge something that is not there? Removing that, strengthening understanding. A lot of people read about Hajj, isn't it? How many people here have gone to Hajj? How many people have been to Hajj? No one. Hajj available in this country or not? Singaporeans, do you have to do Hajj? It's incumbent everywhere. How many people have done Hajj here? Including myself, a good number of people. You must have been reading about Hajj before you go, isn't it? You read books, but it doesn't actually give you a full understanding until you go there, isn't it? Until you go and you go through it, you go through the experience, and then you realize afterwards if someone is going to Hajj and he says, you know, I don't know how to do Hajj. Oh, it's very easy because you've gone through the experience. Thirdly, getting more knowledge. When you practice what you have learned, Allah will teach you. Allah will give you more experiences. Man amila, the Prophet ﷺ says, he who acts upon what he knows, Allah will give him the knowledge of what he has not practiced yet. And fourthly, making it real, testing this knowledge, putting that into action makes people believe you. If you listen to someone saying lots and lots of things, you won't believe him until you see him doing them. and fifthly, gaining people's trust in your message. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not speak too much to people. He would not tell people verbally, you got to do this, you got to do this, you got to do that, you got to do this. But he would actually practice it. And then people would just learn. Silently, would just learn. That's why the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum left the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because number one, he did not highlight their mistakes. Number two, he did not have to speak about things. But he just practiced it. And number six, getting the reward, since it's related to action, not knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not relate the reward of anything to knowing it. That's why in shahada, in kalimat al-tawheed, what do we say? Ashhadu, right? Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Do we say a'lamu? I know. No, we say I bear witness. What is that ashhadu? It's an action. I bear witness. I put that into submission. I submit verbally with my tongue. The ulama said, you can't replace the word of shahada, ashhad, with any other word. You can't say, I know that there is no God except Allah. Although the Quran says, fa'alam. No. But that's different from putting it into action. Yes, you should know that there is no God except Allah, but that is not enough to make you a Muslim. What will make you a Muslim is to submit. Abu Jahl could have known that the Prophet ﷺ was truthful. If he did, he knew that he was truthful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنَّهُمْ لَا يُكَذِّبُونَكَ. They're not holding you as a liar. They don't see you as a liar. They believe you. They know that you are trustworthy. But the thing is, وَلَكِنَّ الظَّالِمِينَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَجْحَدُونَ. But the unjust people, the rejectionists, they will reject the words of God. Until they submit, that will not be considered. So getting the reward is not related to knowing something. It's actually related to putting it into action. However, so step number four is put your knowledge into action. However, don't depend on action. So that's number five. A very important thing. A lot of us see their actions. That's a deception. You see your action. I have done this. I have done this. I have done this. I have done that. I'm a righteous person. Once you see your action, you have not done anything. You're invalidating them. You know, they say once you witness your favors and you say that you have done favors to people, you have invalidated these favors. Once you mention the favor that you've done to someone, to him, and you say, remember, you are in a difficult situation and I've helped you. Is that? It's not a favor anymore. They don't owe you anything anymore. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُبَطِلُوا صَدَقَاتِكُمْ بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى. Oh, you who believe, don't invalidate your charities by mentioning them, by recounting them, by telling people, oh, I've done this to you, I have done that to you, how ungrateful you are, why are you not acknowledging that? Are you doing it for the sake of Allah? Or you're doing it for the sake of people? If you're doing it for the sake of people, people will not appreciate. Do whatever you want. If you're doing it for the sake of Allah, you don't have to mention it to people. You don't have to have an account and say, oh, I have done this, and I've done this, and I've done this, and I've done that. You know, a lot of people do great things, and the Quran does not mention their names, because it doesn't matter if their names are mentioned or not, but it actually matters if their names are recorded with Allah or not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا تعلمونه. You don't know them. الله يعلمه. Allah knows them. That's the most important thing that should remain in your heart, that Allah knows. Allah knows that you've been doing this. Doesn't matter if people give you credit or not. Doesn't matter if people, because people will judge, as we said at the beginning, people will judge what they know. And Allah will judge what He knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You should be happy with what He knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even when you have a complaint, you know, the best thing is not to detail your complaint to Allah. Just say, Ya Rabbi, you know what's in my heart. Help me with it. That's it. Because sometimes language will not carry your complaint. Language is weaker than carrying your complaint. You might not be able to express it eloquently, but your heart does express it eloquently in a different language. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows what is in your heart, will be addressing what is in your heart, not what is in your mouth. So this is very important. We shall not depend on action. They say, I say, غيب عن ملاحظة العمل. لا تغيب عن العمل. Be absent from witnessing your deed. Don't witness your deed. Don't observe what you have done. Don't count what have you done to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran says, يَمُنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا. Are they recounting? Are they telling you that they have become Muslims? I'm seeing that as a favor. That's not a favor. بَلِ اللَّهُ يَمُنُّ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allah is the one who has done you a favor by guiding you to Islam. Allah has given you a favor by guiding you to a gathering of knowledge. Allah has given you a favor by telling you, guiding you to the straight path. Allah has given you a favor by sending the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to us. Allah has given us a favor by guiding us to this deen, that we are born into Muslim family. Or if you're not born into a Muslim family, that you have found your faith later on in life. Otherwise, you would have been completely miserable. SubhanAllah, a couple of weeks ago, a sister from the UK who lives in Egypt, she texted me a few questions about her grandmother who committed suicide because she was afraid of having dementia. You know, dementia is quite high, at high level in the UK specifically. And that woman was afraid of having dementia in the future. She was very elderly and she was afraid that when she gets dementia, there will be no one to help her. So what has she done? She committed suicide. We have loads and loads of Muslims, elderly brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers. When they grow older, the older they grow, the closer they become to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more that we appreciate them and we see that this is a gate for paradise. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you have a father or mother and they have grown very old, if they pass away, Allah will say to you, the person for whose favor or for whose sake we used to honor you and give you risk have passed away now. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, how unblessed is the person who witnesses one or two of his parents while they are at old age and he leaves them pass away without being forgiven. Meaning, this is a way to get forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a time when the person actually, you know, there is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, long, long time ago, that when a person reaches the age of 90 in Islam, right? When a person reaches the age of 90 in Islam, he's called Atiqullah fil Ard. He's the one who's been manumitted by Allah on earth from hellfire. If someone has reached the age of 90 while still being a Muslim, Allah will manumit from hellfire. He will not enter hellfire. 90 years being a Muslim, 90 years of salah, 90 years of ma'rifah, 90 years of ashadu an la ilaha illallah, 90 years of adhan five times a day. Brothers and sisters, if you're working in a company, after doing a long service to that company, the company will be generous enough to give you something at the end, isn't it? To say, you know what, you relax now, we look after your needs. I know that some companies are not like that. They will not be merciful, especially unfortunately in some societies, they will not be merciful to your old age. But in Islam, we are commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be merciful to people at old age. The first people we should be merciful to at old age is our own parents. إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا. If both or one of them reaches an old age, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ. Don't ever say أُفْ to them. Don't say, you've been saying this, you've been doing this, you've been having the go at me all the time. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Don't be rough with them. وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. Be generous and be good and be nice. وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. Lower the wing of mercy to them. They need you. You know, when your parents reach a very old age, in reality, you are working at the level of a father and they are working at the level of a child. It's basically a replacement of the role. They are doing what you used to do as a child and you are doing what they used to do when they were old, at strong age, looking after you. The only difference is that they were doing that wishing a long life for you and you're doing this expecting the day of their death. Right or wrong? Right or wrong? You're saying, when am I going to be relaxed from this? Even at the bottom of your heart, you might be saying, yes, you might say, oh may Allah give them a long life. But it becomes a bit of torture. But the mother never wished that for you. وَاسْتَطْ لَهُمَا جَنَحًا ثُلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. You should not observe your actions. You should not count your actions. Yes, you should do good deeds. But you should never think that your actions will deliver you. What will deliver you? The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why are we doing good actions then? Because we have to do good actions. Imam al-Ghazali recalls a story of one of the righteous people of Allah who worshipped Allah for 70 years. After 70 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to one of the angels, go down to that slave of mine and tell him you've been worshipping Allah, pretended to a man, and tell him that you have been worshipping Allah for 70 years and Allah is going to put you in hellfire. So the angel went down and he said to the man, listen, I'm actually not a man, I'm an angel sent to you by Allah. And Allah is telling you that although you have worshipped him for 70 years, he's going to put you in hellfire. You know what did the man say? He said, I have never worshipped him because of hellfire or because of paradise. I've worshipped him because he deserves to be worshipped. If at the end he decides to put me somewhere, I don't care. That's his decision. He's commanded me to worship him. And he decides where am I supposed to end. When the angel went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said, Ya Rab, you know what he has said. He said, he's been generous with us and we are more generous than him. We will never put him in the fire. He is generous with us. You worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but never think that you are doing something to Allah. Allah is the one who has guided you. Allah is the one who has saved you. Allah is the one who has elevated you. If it has been for your sake, you have lots of those, all of us. I hear it's for one. You know, every one of us has his mistakes and has his problems and has his bad, you know, like backstage problems and backstage defects. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala covers you. That's one thing. Secondly, he makes you look nicer in front of people. I always say to people, if Allah replaces the place of your stomach and makes it close to your mouth, you will never be able to live. You will smell the bad odors of your stomach all the time and no one will speak to you. Right? And you know, at a certain age, if you are unable to clean yourself, how miserable it will be for yourself. So never witness your actions. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu arda said, whoso believes that without effort he will attain his goal is a wishful thinker. You have to do effort. And whoso believes that he will reach his goal by expending efforts only, he's cheated. No, it's the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the one who gives you the power. And Hassan al-Basri radiallahu anhu said, a sign of being in a state of truthfulness is to give up observing the action, not to give up the action itself. You need to give up observing the action and counting it. Number 5 or 6, that if you really want to tread your path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to understand where is the problem with me. You sought advice, someone has given you the advice, you realize that you have to put that into action, you have to realize that fighting your own desires, fighting your own habits, breaking these habits, is not going to be easy. Yes, it's not going to be easy. You know, sticking to salah 5 times a day is something that is not easy. Saying, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, is easy when you are not in a problem, when you are not in affliction. But when you are afflicted by trouble, you forget. Seriously, you forget. When you lose someone who's very close to you, when something bad happens to you, you remember everything, all complaints, but you forget to say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And in reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you ever remember this at that point, it means that your iman is strong. You remember. You know, when there is a problem, what is the first thing that you will remember? When someone is attacking you, you remember to call the police. You remember. The first thing that comes in your mind is the thing that is going to serve you, the thing that is going to save you, the thing that is going to take you out, the thing that is going to extend the helping hand to you. In reality, when you are in a disaster, the first one that is going to help you is Allah. As much as you remember to call 999 if you're in the UK, you remember to call Divine Line. This Divine Line is never busy. It's open all the time. Break your habits and remember that no one can help you except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not going to be easy. You will fail. I always say to the students and the brothers and sisters, failure starts when you lose hope that you can restart. Failure starts at the point when you say, oh, I'm not going to be able to do it. That's failure. You will not be able to do it. Always give yourself the hope that, no, inshallah, there is a second chance. There is another chance. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَمَلْ حَتَّ تَمَلْ. Allah will never be fed up with you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never ever close his gates against you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never turn you away. In the hadith narrated by Imam al-Nawawi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, hadith al-Qudsi, Ya ibn Adam, innaka ma da'awtani wa rajawtani, ghafartu laka ala ma kana minka wa la ubali. O son of Adam, as long as you're asking me, you're praying to me, you are having hope in me, I will forgive you, regardless of who you are, regardless of what sins you have. Regardless of what is your background, what is your package that you're coming with, regardless of how you choose your sins, because Allah is greater than that. The mercy of Allah is encompassing all of that. Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, in his deathbed, he said, وَلَمَّا قَسَرَ قَلْبِ وَضَاقَتْ مَذَاهِبِي, when my heart became very hard and tight, and I realized that all the gates are closed in front of me, جَعَلْتُ الرَّجَى مِنِّي لِعَفْوِكَ سُلَّمًا, I used my hope to be the ladder to your pardoning. I took that my means to get your forgiveness, my hope in you. تَعَظَمَنِي ذَنْبِي, I looked at my sins and they were really big. فَلَمَّا قَرَنْتُهُ بِعَفْوِكَ رَبِّي كَانَ عَفْوُكَ أَعْظَمَ, but when I compared that with your forgiveness, I realized that your forgiveness is greater than my sins. Regardless, how long your sins will be for? Failure. How did I say 5 minutes? Failure happens, brothers and sisters, when we lose hope that we can change. You know, that's why I always say to the brothers and the sisters, you know, there is this French proverb which I had the guts to change a bit. You know, Cheikh Shayla Fan. Have you heard that before? They say, obviously the French, not me, look for the lady. Meaning, if there is a problem, always look for the woman. The French say that. No, but I said, cherche la motif. Look for your intention. What do you want to do? I want to fix myself. Right? I want to fix my nose. How long have I been building this personality for? 28 years, 30 years, 40 years. It will take another 40, equal amount of time to fix it. It's as simple as this. And it doesn't matter if you die before you fix your nafs completely. But it matters that you will be meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a state of struggle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who struggle in our path, we guide them to our way. If you struggle and you say, Ya Rabbi, I've done my best. Yes, I have trodden the path. I have taken the step. I have moved in your direction. But being delivered is not my responsibility, isn't it? When you make all your planning for Hajj, and then all of a sudden, because of influenza or a plague or an epidemic, they decide to cancel the Hajj, will Allah punish you for that? No, possibly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will write you amongst those who are in Hajj. If you go to Hajj and you die halfway, you will be buried in your ihram. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as happened at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, plan your life, know your abilities. One of the reasons for failure is that sometimes you say, I will do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. No, Imam al-Ghazali tells you, make sure that if you can do a little bit, do that little bit, but keep it. Keep it for many, many months, many years. Change has to be slow, but sure. It has to be sure, regardless of how slow it is. Some of these helpers that can actually, some of the things that can help you have a good start into fixing yourself. Number one, realize the temporariness of this world. Regardless of how long will you live, you will never be able to live here eternally. And had we had a longer time, I would have told you the story of a man called Luqman ibn Ad, who wanted to live for 4,000 years, and he did live. He wanted to live eternally, and he lived for 4,000 years. But if you realize that is how short life is, that will help you. Okay, let me start working now. Number two, abstain from evil deeds is a thermometer. A lot of people don't realize that they are moving forward in the path to Allah, even if they don't know it. Ask yourself, am I praying 5 times a day? Alhamdulillah. There are others who don't pray 5 times a day. Then you are on the right path. Oh, I'm praying 3 times a day. Okay, there are people who don't pray at all. I'm doing good deeds. Alhamdulillah, there are people who are not doing anything. Alhamdulillah, no? I'm abstaining from what is evil. That's good, alhamdulillah, that's a start. Soon, something will happen. And number three, reflect upon the Quran. Read the stories of the Quran. Read what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done to the people before us. How change is slow, requires patience. And number four, shifting the zeal and determination from body to the soul. A lot of us focus a lot on the body. In our change in life, we think about the position, about our size, about our beard, about our clothing, about what do we, how have I changed over the past 2 years in terms of external state? But you never ask yourself, how's my soul now? Is it in a better state? When the Quran is recited, do I cry? Do I feel or not? Do I still think ill of people? Do I still despise people? Do I still see that I'm better than people? Imam al-Ghazali says in Bidayat al-Hidayah, if you see anyone, always think that you are worse than them. If you see a scholar saying, Subhanallah, he's a man of knowledge, you have no knowledge. If you see an ignorant person, say to yourself, Alhamdulillah, this person is better than me. Even when he commits sins, he commits them with ignorance, he doesn't know. But I know. And I commit sins while knowingly. This is a disaster. Allah will excuse him for his ignorance, but he will not excuse me for my knowledge. And if you see a Muslim, say, Alhamdulillah, this person is better than me, I am sinful. If you see a kafir, a non-Muslim, say, Allahu A'lam, this person is possibly better than me. Possibly Allah will end his life in Iman. And my life, I don't know how is it going to end. Never think that you are better than anyone. Shift your zeal and your determination and your focus from the body to the soul. Placing the zeal in the body, as he says, Rahimahullah, makes you the slave of the body. If it's all about the body that you have, then you are the slave of that body. Imam al-Ghazali says, Ya khadim al-jismi kam tas'a li khidmatihi. Atatlubu al-ribha mimma fihi khusran. O servant of the body, how often do you serve it? How often do you think about the needs of your body? Do you aim to gain from that which decays? Your body will extinct one day. It will decay one day. Everything that you are putting in, all these fingernails that have been writing a lot of good things, they will decay one day. Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala said, أَمُوتُ وَيَبْقَى كُلُّ شَيْءٍ كَتَبْتُ. I will die, and everything that I've written will remain. فَيَا لَيْتَ مَنْ يَقْرَى كِتَابِي دَعَالِيًا. So I hope that the one who reads what I've written makes dua for me. So make sure that what you're writing is good, is something that will please you on the day of Qiyamah. لَعَلَّ إِلَهِ أَنْ يَمُنَّ بِلُطْفِهِ. Hoping that my Lord will be gentle to me. وَيَغْفِرَ زَلَّاتِي وَسُوءَ فِعَالِيًا. And He will forgive my slips and my evil deeds. Make sure that your focus is on the nafs. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to the best of deeds. May subhanahu wa ta'ala show us the ugliness of ourselves and the beauty in others. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم صلى الله عليه وسلم محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.